But we've had a good time. We've had a good time last night, good time this morning. Exciting to see the Lord work. We've got a number of missionaries that have come from all over the place to be with us here today, tomorrow, and Wednesday. And I just want to remind everyone that they do have several displays set up both to your left over here around the corner of the stage, and also to your right around the corner inside this door have a number of missionaries set up. And I'd like to encourage you to go by and pick up a prayer card. Be sure we're in prayer for these men and these women that are here today. And then also, we have our registration table. So if you're just coming in this morning, we've got a Jubilee registration table, and ask that you please fill out a card, let us know who you are, what you're up to, and then just slip it into that clear box over there. But I would like to ask for Brother Stan, if you would, go ahead and make your way up this way. Now, you missionaries, I've talked to you, and it's the same way every year. And we're not trying to be harsh, but we know that little is much when God is in it. So you got 3 minutes. 3 minutes, and just share your heart. Tell us about what the Lord's doing in your ministry. And then I believe the Lord will bless that. Now, I think if we go 3 minutes and 1 second, though, I'm pretty sure that the blessing ceased. So, Brother Stan, you go ahead and come at this time. Tell us about yourself.
All right. I want to tell you two things. First of all, I want to tell you about grace in my life. And secondly, I want to tell you that the Jewish people are still making bricks without straw, wearing their chains proudly today. I was born into an Orthodox Jewish household. My grandfather was an Orthodox rabbi. At the age of 12, somebody came off her porch on the night of Passover. I was trying to get home before dark. She grabbed me by my arm and said, "Why are you Jews still roasting the Passover lamb? Didn't you know Jesus was the Lamb of God slain once for your sins?" Amen. I looked up at her. I said, "No, ma'am, I never heard that before. Is that true?" And she had enough nerve to tell me that much, and not enough nerve to tell me any more. 5 years later, I heard the rest of the gospel. I played hooky from school to go to a baseball game at Shea Stadium, and I got there, and there was a Billy Graham crusade there with a red and white banner that said, "Come hear about the Lamb of God." You'd have thought I was watching the best baseball game ever. I realized that I was a sinner, and that not turning lights on and off at night on Friday and not eating ham or pork and all of that was going to send me to hell, and I repented of all that mess. And I went forward during the invitation, and the personal worker said, "Would you like to trust Christ as your Savior?" In tears, I said, "I would. I'd love to, but I'm Jewish. I'm not allowed to do that." We take it for granted. She opened her Bible up and turned to John 3:16 and had me read one word, and that word was "whosoever." She said, does whosoever include little Jewish boys? I said, "I believe it does." I trusted Christ as my Savior that night. 2 days later, got declared dead and disowned by my family, but the God that saved me has taken care of me ever since. And I might say today that we're missionaries to the Jewish people of America, teaching and training our independent fundamental Bible-believing Baptist churches how to witness to the Jewish people, how to speak their language. Because of time, I'll just share one verse and one item. The one verse is Romans 1:16. We all know it, and it's to the Jew first and also the Greek. But the way we practice it is we knock on a door, and the person says, "Well, I'm Jewish," and we walk away. We say, "Well, I'm sorry," and we walk away because we don't speak their language. In their language, on Hanukkah, the 8 nights of Hanukkah, middle candle is the servant candle called the Shamash. We know Jesus came in the form of a servant. It gives light to the other candles. You never light the other candle first. You always light the servant candle. It gives light to the other candles. Does that sound like somebody you know? And again, we're available for meetings and teaching and training, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 day Jewish soul winning revivals. And it's become an actual revival and seeing Jewish people saved. Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Let's not forget he did come to the Jew first. We're so thankful for that. Now, Brother Adam Wells, go ahead and come at this time. Brother Adam Wells has a terrific ministry to the deaf. And he does more than just signing. He does training. He's got deaf churches that he works with as well. And we're honored to have him here, Brother Adam Wells.
Hey, Adam, Pastor. Why am I standing here? Brother Dale Vance said his best wasn't much. Who do I think I am? I am going to turn my hands off, if you don't mind interpreting for me. They can't see me very well. Anyway, here. In 2004, in the summer, I was visited at my restaurant by a deaf soul winner. A deaf man that was concerned about a hearing man's soul. You know, soul winning still works. Amen. You know, tracks still change lives. I kept this. Amen. You know, this is like gold for me. I kept this. Because everything that happens, every deaf person I reach, every hearing church that has a deaf ministry that I help, every soul that gets saved through our ministry, whatever it is all connected back to this one deaf man. You know why he was the way he was? Because he was discipled in an indigenous deaf church. An indigenous deaf church. And what we're about is taking this book, and I still don't understand for the life of me why God would use me for anything. But look, see this book? I don't know why God would let me take this book, this King James Bible. Not the deaf Bible, not the low English Bible, not the you can't understand it Bible. Not the deaf are too dumb to get it Bible. Amen. This is the King James Bible that the deaf can understand. Somehow they get it. And see, it's the washing of the water by the word. The amount of growth in your life as a Christian comes from how much of this book gets into your heart and affects your life. And the problem is we've got a lot of deaf that are born again through great ministries, big deaf ministries, the Bill Rice Ranch, all these names that you know. But for all practical purposes, the fruit of their life is the same as the thief on the cross because they haven't been discipled. And so if your deaf ministry needs a shot in the arm, if you're thinking about starting a deaf ministry, if the millions of deaf people who cannot hear the gospel because faith cometh by, and hearing by the, if you can't hear, if that bothers you, please come see me. Amen? Amen. And I'll do everything I can to help you on your way. God bless you.
God bless these men. Brother Zane, why don't you go ahead and make your way this way. Brother Zane works working in India with Brother Danny Tessanier. He's about 55 years old, I think it is. Getting close. With Ain't God Good Ministries, great to have you here. Brother Zane Meyer.
Well, it's been good this week. I thank the pastor for the accommodations and the preaching and the good food. And I'm Zane Meyer. I'm with Ain't God Good Ministries, founded by Danny Tessanier. I'm out of the Metropolitan Baptist Church in Wheeling, West Virginia. I was saved when I was about 8 years old, raised in church all my life, and I've graduated from the Faith Bible Institute. I was, on January 7th of 2013, at the age of 15, I surrendered to God's call to be a missionary to India. And then God brought me and Brother Danny together back last April, and then I joined him in November. We have two Bible colleges and two children's homes. We have over 50 students enrolled in our Bible colleges, and we provide room and board as they are discipled in the Word of God so we can go and we can train them. They can go reach the 1.3 billion people of India. Amen. It's difficult for us to go out being foreign missionaries and go ourselves and do evangelism, so we train the nationals and equip them to go plant churches of their own, take over pastoring churches so we can reach the Hindus and the Muslims of India. We have two children's homes. Like I said, there's 30 children living there, and we provide a safe home for these children where we can give them the gospel daily, where they can be raised under the Word of God so that one day they can grow up and they can pass on what they've learned to their children and to their children's children. Most of these children don't have a father, so we try to introduce them to the Heavenly Father. Amen. And there's some, if their fathers have passed away, their mothers can't take care of them. So we provide their meals and their spiritual needs as well as their physical needs. So we appreciate your prayers. Again, most of you here know Brother Danny Tessinier, and I know he appreciates your prayers and your support. And then I just ask that you pray for me as I go and I try to raise personal support for Ain't God Good Ministries.
Amen. Thank you. Amen.
Don't stop this for a second. 18 years old.
Amen.
He's going to go and support, be a support staff. And this actually wasn't his first place he's supposed to go. He hadn't been to the first one yet, his first meeting yet. This, he kind of got in here, and I want to pick him up for $50. Just
Amen.
Brother Joe and Brother Anthony, all in favor of doing that. We're going to pick him up $50 a month and just give him a little punch in the arm. And we're going to take up an offering in a moment so you can think about it. I want to give him the offering today so you have some money on the road, okay? So y'all do real good in a moment.
Amen. Amen. I'm not biased or anything. This is the best church in America. I love being here. Brother Mike Haley, why don't you go ahead and run this way just as fast as you can. We're going to time you. Your clock's going to start in 3 seconds. Brother Mike Haley served in Romania for many years, and now he's heading to Botswana in Africa. And it's an honor to have him with us as well.
Lord bless you. I'm getting a complex because 15 years ago I was here on my way to Romania, sitting all the way in the back, and preacher said, Mike, you've got 1 minute and the clock is ticking. Somebody has told something about me that I don't know how to tell time. Amen. We're on our way to Botswana, Africa, by the grace of God and the joy of our heart to go back to the mission field. We were in Romania, and this church was very gracious to support that work, and God blessed in wondrous fashion. And we always knew when we came home that eventually we'd head back to the mission field, and now at this stage in our life, God has allowed us that joy, and we'll be heading to Botswana, Africa. Most folks don't know where Botswana is. It's just north of South Africa. It's a great country in that it's very open to the gospel, and we are working with BIMI. We'll be the first family with BIMI, be going this summer. I'm going to ask you specifically to pray for a six-week period of time that we'll be there this summer trying to legalize everything so that other missionaries can follow us in and join in that work. But Lord willing, we'll be leaving permanently in January and beginning our work there. We'll be working with Carl and Bonnie Clark, who've been in Africa for over 30 years, and a team ministry helping to get nationals doctrinally sound. How many of you remember Jim Jones and Guyana? That is going on in Botswana, Africa today, and it's a black cloud. The charismatic movement is a black cloud that's hanging over Botswana, Africa. And folks, let me just say this. I just want to give you one illustration of that. What they're teaching is that when you take communion, that you should drink diesel fuel, and that somehow that's going to honor God and exhibit your faith. Now, how many of us understand when there's an absence of Bible doctrine and what is sound and what is right and what is true, anything goes? Now, that's what sends folks to hell. And we want to take the light, the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ, to those who live in darkness. It's the greatest honor of my life to be able to do that, and we'd appreciate your prayers. Thank you, preacher. It's good to be back, and it's good to have your support once again. And we love this church, appreciate this church, and looking forward to the blessing of serving alongside of you once again. Thank you for your prayers. How many of you are Baptist preachers? May I see your hand, please, if you're a Baptist preacher? Hey, brethren, every Baptist preacher loves a bargain, so I'm going to give you a bargain. If you'll get a prayer card this morning, we'll let you have one for free. After this morning, they double in price. All right, so get one this morning. But in all sincerity, please pray for us.
Amen.
Your prayers will enable us to do what God's given us to do, and we rejoice in that. Amen. Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, preacher.
Thank you. Ushers, will you come real quickly, please? And I want the New Hope Quartet to come and... Have you enjoyed the New Hope Quartet? Hadn't they been a blessing? Now, yeah, give them a big hand again as they come. Now, they're going to be leaving and going back to Burlington. They're in that Big Ten meeting. It'll start back tonight. The meeting started in Brother Hobbs' church, and they're obligated to go back. But they have been a blessing to us. Thank God. Now, this offering was at Give me my brother's name again.
Zane Meyer.
Zane's 18 years old. Now, you want to encourage somebody, give a get offering this morning. I'll ever give this young man so he can travel to get where he needs to be, all right? Let's pray. Our Father, I ask you to bless now as we get into our second message in a moment. And Lord, bless the music, God, as it prepares our hearts. And Lord, we do want to bow our heart to you and worship you and give you our best. Lord, help us to give our best in this offering to help this young champion for Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
That he brings, lifting up my hands to the great I am, let me never be ashamed. With all that is within me now, well, bless his holy name. Now Jesus is to be my everything, and I bless the day he came.
When he gave me drink from the fountain sweet, so I'll never thirst again.
Now through the Spirit of the Son to the Father I can say,
for your saving blood and for all you've done, bless your holy and sweet name. Oh, bless the Lord, yes, bless the Lord, well, bless his holy name. Let me not forget all his benefits or the blessings that he brings. Lifting up my hands to the great I am, let me never be ashamed. With all that is within me now, well, bless his holy name. Someday I'll move beyond the blue where a better home awaits. There to lay aside for a crown of life from the sorrow, death, and pain. To see my loved ones and to know I've left this world behind, I will lift my hands and I'll praise his name while shouting through the skies. Oh, bless the Lord, yes, bless the Lord, well, bless his holy name. Let me not forget all his benefits or the blessings that he brings. Lifting up my hands to the great I am, let me never be ashamed. With all that is within me now, well, bless his holy name. Oh, bless the Lord, yes, bless the Lord, well, bless his holy name. Let me not forget all his benefits or the blessings that he brings. Lifting up my hands to the great I am, let me never be ashamed. With all that is within me now, well, bless his holy name. With all that is within me now, well, bless his holy name.
If I could say one thing, it'd be he's the best thing. If I had only one word, Jesus would be heard. If I had but one breath, I'd use it to praise him with. For he is really all that matters. When this thing is over, across death's cold water,
away. And if this were my last mile, I'd spend it praising him a while. If I had but one breath, I'd use it to praise him with. For he is really all.
Sure, it's good to be saved this morning, and I'm thankful for God's grace and thankful for how good the Lord is to us. And it's another opportunity, it's a wonderful honor for us to be here again this year. We love this meeting. We thank God for all what all he's doing through it. I find help for my life around here, and that's what church will do for you. When you get in the house of God, you'll find help for your life. You'll find help in here you ain't gonna find nowhere else. And I thank God for it, and I thank God for Brother John extending this invitation and being so gracious to let us leave after this morning to get back home for our meeting. But coming to a meeting like this, it gets me fired up to go to heaven. And I thank God for the wonderful fellowship we're going to have while the ages roll. I'm looking forward to seeing Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Brother Cody. I'm looking forward to meeting Brother Paul, and I'm looking forward to meeting preachers of our past that we look up to. I'm looking forward to meeting Billy Sunday, and I'm looking forward to meeting Ralph Sexton Sr., and I'm looking forward to meeting Percy Ray and all these great men we look forward to meeting. But I'm telling you, I can't talk to none of them till I get down on my feet before the throne of God and thank him for what all he's done for me. And this is what this old song says, when I thank you for what he's done, and hope this will be a blessing to your heart tonight. Now, what's the first word of this song? Someday, when I enter heaven's city, all the bright treasures that I've won. Oh, but how can I ever receive them? Yeah.
at the feet of my sweet Jesus. Oh, and I must thank Him for all that He's done. Well, when I thank Him for what He has done, oh, I must look back to the to thank Him for what He has done. When I thank Him for what He has done, must look back to the crucified One on that beautiful shore. I must kneel once more just to thank Him for
praying. Let's just sing a little of that chorus ourselves. You think it'll be all right? How many of you thank God for what He's done? Man, I look back at my life and look where God's brought me from and has allowed me. Look at all these preacher boys up here. They're needed. Let's sing it. I'll help you.
When I thank Him for what He has done, oh, I must look back to the crucified One on that beautiful shore. Oh, I must kneel once more just to thank Him for what He has done.
We're going to do it again, man. Come on, help me.
Well, when
come on,
I
are you doing your best? Dale said we ought to do our best. Sing it, children. Praise Him.
Just to thank Him for what He has done.
Somebody, some of y'all pray with Ricky right there. Brokenhearted preacher man, refined to a wheelchair. Some of us, we got our legs, we got our health, we got our sight. Hear it.
just to thank Him for what He has done. Oh, when I thank Him for what He has done. Oh, I must look back to the just to thank Him for what He has done. Now before I can shout hallelujah, oh, and before I can sing redemption song, oh, I must kneel at the feet of my Jesus, oh, and I must thank Him for all that He's done. Oh, when I thank just to thank Him for what He has done. Well, when I thank Him for what He has done, oh, I must look back to the crucifixion. Just to thank Him for what He has done. Someday when I enter heaven's city to receive the bright treasures I've won, oh, but how can I ever accept them? Oh, until I thank Him for what He has done. Oh, when I thank Him for what He has done, oh, I must look to the crucified one. just to thank Him for what He has done. Now before I can shout hallelujah, oh, and before I can sing redemption song, oh, I must kneel at the feet of Jesus, oh, and I must thank Him for all that He's done. Well, when I thank just to thank Him for what He has done.
Faced a mountain, and once again it seemed so tall. I tried to climb, but it seemed I'd surely fall. So I knelt and I called on my Jesus, and just as always I felt His presence. And like before, He's given victory.
patient and like before. He's given victory.
First sermon yet, or no devotional, nothing. But I told him to take about 3 or 4 minutes and share his testimony, preach, do whatever you want to do.
Yes, sir.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Then they're going to come out to Jesus.
I'm glad to be here, church. What God's doing in here is amazing to me. I just want to thank him today for what he's done. I'll just share my testimony. I was saved in this church at the age of 4. At that young of an age, growing up in a godly home, you know, a lot of people think you don't got it. But man, I can tell you I had it. And I'm glad for that. The Lord came in my heart. He saved me from the miry pits of clay at the age of 4. At the age of 4. I realized I was a sinner. I was lost on my way to hell. My oh my. Without him, what would I be? Thank you, Lord. I tell you where I'd be. If it wasn't for him, I'd be dead right now. I can guarantee that. I can guarantee that. I promise you, I'd be in a devil's hell right now without him. He spared me too many times. Too many times. And to make it all even better, just about a month ago, May 11th, around 9 o'clock, that Wednesday evening. You know, a lot had been going on in my life, and I didn't really know what was going on, but the Lord was trying to get a hold of me. He's given me this burden and this desire in my heart for about a year or so, and I've been dealing with the call to preach. And I just got down with God, started doing a devotion, started praying, and I said, Lord, if you want me to preach, you show me. You give me the clearest thing you possibly can. I better watch what I ask for next time. My Bible fell open to 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse number 2 through 7. The very first words that I saw was preach the word. Preach the word. Preach the word to this lost and dying world. Preach the word. Mama, what a title that is. What a charge that is that he's given me. Mama. He wants me to tell this world what his son did for me, what his son's doing for them. Woo, glory. There ain't nothing else that I would want to do. There's nothing else that I am going to do. I'm going to stay in his will, and I'm going to preach the word.
Song, all right. Come on, I'm gonna get in this quartet again, people. Come on.
Jesus wins again. Still with the thing.
Still.
For my home and family, for all life's joys that you've given me, for shoes on my
Man. I'm trying to find my way out of this, amen. And Brian, you're going to be the one to get out of it, amen. This is West Virginia Jubilee. I don't know if we're exactly where you preached us at, but I sense I'm getting close because I want to give my best. When we set this meeting up, we set it up to go a certain way. Honestly. And some of you came to hear Dr. Gibbs today, and pray for him. He broke his leg, got a real bad infection, couldn't come. But I think he wouldn't mind God. And our friend, Brother Brian McBride, Evangelist Brian McBride, I want him to come. And Brian, I know how to do this. I'll tell you how to do it. When it's real high or it's real low, just preach your way out of it. Amen. Welcome to the pulpit, the evangelist, Brian McBride.
What time do you want me to be done? Amen. Well, I was in a meeting like this once, and the preacher said, we're going to have Brother McBride come and do whatever he wants to. So I said, let's be dismissed and go eat. Amen. I give you a thought or two this morning. And Matthew chapter 27, I won't keep you long, but I'll give you a thought or two. Isn't it wonderful what the Lord's doing? And I just enjoyed it. I was going to say sit back and see what the Lord's doing, and I enjoy that, but I like better getting in on what the Lord is doing. And I'm thankful for the church here. Thank you for inviting me to come. Thank you for the good message we've already heard today. And then the good number from our quartet. I believe I saw that boy on the end smile this morning. Amen. That was a blessing. I saw a little grin in there. That was good. And I'm glad to be here today. And I like this new pulpit. Amen. I think the Bible says something about those things which cannot be shaken. And so I like this new pulpit. I want to spend a few moments, just a few moments this morning in the book of Matthew and the 27th chapter. And I want to spend a little time in these next three mornings around Calvary. And I want us to consider the crucifixion and some things that take place around the crucifixion that might be instructive and helpful to us and encouraging to us in these next 3 days. And so I want to read a little bit in the 27th chapter of the book of Matthew. When the morning was come, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And when they had bound him, they led him away and delivered him to Pontius Pilate, the governor. Then Judas, which had betrayed him, when he saw that he was condemned, repented himself and brought again the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And they said, what is that to us? See thou to that. And he cast down the pieces of silver in the temple and departed and went and hanged himself. And the chief priest took the silver pieces and said, it is not lawful for to put them into the treasury, because it is the price of blood. And they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field to bury strangers in. Wherefore that field was called the field of blood unto this day. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremy the prophet, saying, and they took the 30 pieces of silver, the price of him that was valued, whom they of the children of Israel did value, and gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord appointed me. And Jesus stood before the governor. And the governor asked him, saying, art thou the king of the Jews? And Jesus said unto him, thou sayest. And when he was accused of the chief priests and elders, he answered nothing. Then said Pilate unto him, hearest thou not how many things they witness against thee? And he answered him to never a word, insomuch that the governor marveled greatly. Now at the feast, the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. And they had then a notable prisoner called Barabbas. Therefore, when they were gathered together, Pilate said unto them, Whom will ye that I release unto you, Barabbas or Jesus, which is called Christ? For he knew that for envy they had delivered him. When he was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, Have thou nothing to do with this just man, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. But the chief priests and elders persuaded the multitude that they should ask Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor answered and said unto them, Whether of the twain will ye that I release unto you? They said, Barabbas. Pilate saith unto them, What shall I do then with Jesus, which is called Christ? They all say unto him, Let him be crucified. And the governor said, Why? What evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, Let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it. Then answered all the people and said, His blood be on us and on our children. Then released he Barabbas unto them. And when he had scourged Jesus, he delivered him to be crucified. I want to, in these next three mornings, spend a few moments considering some truths about the crucifixion. This morning, for just the next few moments, I want to talk to you about some conversion truths from the trial of the Lord Jesus. Tomorrow morning, the Lord willing, we will look at some comprehensive truths from the tree of our Lord Jesus. And then on Wednesday, if the Lord will allow us, I want to spend a moment or two on some comforting truths concerning the tomb of our Lord Jesus. But I want us to think about this trial for a little while. I know that the central figure in this trial, the central character, the central person is the Lord Jesus. But there are three other people that are intricately involved in this trial, and what the Bible says about them teaches us some truths about salvation and about conversion, about what's really involved in becoming a child of God. I want us to notice, and I will be as brief as I can this morning, but I want you to notice, first of all, this man Judas. And I will call him this morning the remorseful sinner. Judas is the remorseful sinner. The Bible tells us that after he betrayed the Lord, in verse number 3 of chapter 27, when he had betrayed him, that he saw that he was condemned, repented himself, and brought again the 30 pieces of silver. And he said, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. And here is a man who is so remorseful over his sin, so sorrowful about what he has done, that he ends up hanging himself. The Bible says that he went out and hanged himself in verse number 5. I would like to say to you very simply this morning that though sorrow is involved, I think, in salvation, it will not save you and keep you out of hell. I would say to you, it matters not how sorry you are. Some folks try and work up in themselves a sorrow, and they point to how remorseful they are. But here's what Paul said in Corinthians. He said, godly sorrow worketh repentance unto salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death. I would suggest to you that this man, Judas, is sorry because of the consequence of what he did rather than sorry for what he did. And that kind of sorrow will never bring you to God. It will always take you away from God as it did in his life. You think about this man Judas and the possibilities that were in his life. He was one of the disciples, one of the 70. You think about the things he had seen, the miracles that had been done. Someone said, well, Judas certainly never did any miracles. Well, now wait a minute. If he traveled with the disciples and with the apostles and was numbered with them, don't you think somebody would have thought it odd along the way if God never worked through him, if there never were any miracles? As somebody said, well, I know that I belong to God because I've seen this and experienced that. Well, there's a lot of folks who have experienced unusual things and outstanding things that have never known God. Jesus warned about those who would say to him, have we not done many mighty works in thy name? And the Bible tells us, and we are warned, that even Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light, and that his ministers are transformed, or his servants into ministers of righteousness. So here is a man who had possibilities. He saw great things. Now, I am not of the opinion that Judas was ordained to go to hell. You might be of that opinion, but I think you're mistaken. I believe he could have been saved. As a matter of fact, the Bible says, said that in that Last Supper, he was the one that dipped his sop with the Lord. When you study that dipping of the sop, it is a very important thing that goes on. It is a mark of honor. It is really a mark of invitation. And I believe the Lord was giving Judas another chance, but he turned his back upon the Lord, and the Bible said Satan entered into him, and then he went out and betrayed the Lord, and he died in his sin. Now, I just want to say this, and then I'm going to move on. I was reading a book by a man named Henry D'Urbanville, and he was telling about the last days of Jesus, and here's what he said. He said he was teaching in a little girl's school in the nation of France. He was teaching through the Bible, and he came to the story and the account of Judas betraying the Lord. So as he taught about Judas, he noticed that God was moving among the young ladies in the class. And so finally, he stopped and he looked at them, and here was the question he asked. He said, young ladies, if you had betrayed the Lord like Judas, would you have gone out and hanged yourself? And one young lady with tears in her eyes lifted her hand, and she said, sir, if I had betrayed the Lord like Judas, I would have gone and hung my arms around the neck of Jesus and asked him to forgive me. Now I want to tell you, that's what godly sorrow is. That's what godly repentance is. It doesn't drive you from him. It draws you to him. It'll cause you to throw your arms around him and ask you to forgive him for your sin. Sorrow is not enough. Then there is another man involved. I'll mention him briefly. His name is Pilate. He is involved also in this trial. If Judas is the remorseful sinner, then I would call Pilate the respectable sinner. When you look at Pilate, he would seem to be, from what we read of him in the scripture, the opposite of Judas. And when I look at Pilate, I think about the fact that not only will sorrow not get us to heaven, but symbolism will not get us to heaven. I think about Pilate's ordered life. When you read about him, he's called the governor. He is introduced to us as the governor. He is referred to as the governor 6 times in the Bible. Now, if a man has become a politician, and he has worked his way up in the Roman Empire and become a man of authority, I would have to believe in some measure that he is well ordered, that he is careful in his steps and careful in how people see him. And we see that in our text. The Bible said he's going to deliver up Jesus because he doesn't want to offend the Jews. He doesn't want there to be a tumult. He is a man with an ordered life, a man in charge. Not only does he have an ordered life, but he has, it seems to be, a pretty good opinion of Christ. He will say, why? what evil hath he done? He will say, this just man. He will say, I find no fault in him. But here's his problem. His problem is that all of his hope is centered in outward things. Here's what he does. When he brings Jesus, he gets him a basin of water. And he washes his hands in the water, and then he says, I am innocent of the blood of this just man. Now I want to ask you a question. Did that water clean the blood off his hands? Because he washed himself in the bowl, did that water make him right with God? No, it was a symbol, and symbols have no power. Whether it is a statue, whether it is a crucifix, whether it is a baptismal pool, whatever it is, it has no regenerative power. You can get baptized, you can pray certain prayers, you can say certain words, you can go through certain motions, but none of that will get you to God. None of it will save you. Symbolism is not enough. The Bible said, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Now, there's one more man. His name is Barabbas. He is the released sinner. He's the one that got delivered. He's the one that got out from under condemnation. Amen. Judas didn't, because sorrow won't get it done. Pilate didn't get out from under condemnation because symbolism won't get it done. But Barabbas got out from under condemnation because substitution will get the job done. Somebody dying in my place. Somebody taking my judgment. Somebody taking my sin. That's what gets you into heaven. Jesus dying in your place. He was unfit to be released. You know what he's called? Hallelujah, this helps me. He's called a notable sinner. They had a notable prisoner. You know what I was? I was a notable sinner. I was of note, a sinner of note. I wasn't just a little sinner. I was a sinner of note. I was notable in my wickedness. But thank God Jesus was willing to die in my place. You know what? A notable sinner needs a notable Savior. Hallelujah. I've got one. Well, not only was he unfit for release, but now you listen to this. He was uninvolved in the negotiations for his release.
Amen.
They didn't call old Barabbas up and say, now how do you think we could get you out of here? How do you think we could get you out from under condemnation? Nope. He's just sitting down there in the prison, and somebody else is working it all out. Amen. Somebody else is making all the arrangements. Amen. Somebody else is doing all the work. That's exactly what happened to me. I didn't do any bargaining with God. It had all been taken care of before the foundation of the world. The Lamb of God had died in my place. He's unfit for release. He is uninvolved in his negotiations. But he is unloosed from his prison. Amen. Now, lest you misunderstand me, I did not design my salvation, but I did have a decision to make concerning it. I did not come up with the plan of salvation, but I had to personally take sides with Jesus in order to be saved. Amen. He did not force me to be saved. He just put it all in place. I was just sitting down there in the prison waiting to hear the executioner come, listening for his steps and fearing the worst. But lo and behold, when I heard the steps, it wasn't the executioner after all. It was the messenger of God come to tell me that somebody was going to die in my place. Somebody had paid my penalty, and I could go free. Substitution. The just dying for the unjust. Substitution. Hallelujah. The spotless lamb on the altar dying for the spotted sinner. Substitution. Jesus. The Bible said, for he, God, hath made him, Jesus, to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The guilty go free because the innocent goes to the cross. I didn't have to pay the debt because Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Amen.
I was preaching a little while ago, and my friend Chad Bailey was talking to me, and he told me this story. He said there was a little tribe that had a chief who was the final authority of everything that went on in the tribe. They had very few laws, didn't really need them. But they had a law against stealing. And one day, things began to be found missing. Somebody was stealing. So it went on a little while, and the chief declared that when the thief was found, he would be tied to a post and receive 10 lashes. Well, they didn't find the thief. More things came up missing. And so the chief said, when the thief is found, we'll tie him to the post, and he'll receive 20 lashes. They didn't find the thief. More things were missing. Every few days, things were missing. The chief would pronounce a heavier sentence until finally, the thief, if he were found, were to receive 50 lashes. Then one day, the thief was discovered in the midst of stealing. It was the chief's elderly mother who had been stealing things and concealing them in her little hut. So when word got out that the chief's mother was the culprit, everyone wondered what would happen. The chief had said 50 lashes, but everybody knew that that frail woman would die under 50 lashes. The day came for the sentence to be carried out. The village all gathered around to see what the chief would do. Would law win or would love win? So they took that elderly woman and they tied her to the post. And the man with the whip stepped up. And just as he raised his arm, the chief halted. He ordered them to halt. Stand up. And he stepped up to his elderly mother who was tied to the post. And he wrapped his arms around her. And he said, carry out the sentence. You see, law won and love won.
Amen.
And that's what happened to me when Jesus died on the cross.
Amen.
Law was satisfied and love was satisfied.
Amen.
He died for me. He died in my place. But he died for you.
Amen.
And he died in your place. Now, how can we do any less than live for him after he has died for us? I'm done, preacher. Would you stand, please? I thought of these dear missionaries going to the field. Jesus gave his life for them. Now they're giving their lives for him. Substitution. Oh, sinner friend, he took your place. I think our sister's going to play. And maybe God would have you to come. You might want to. I know you already have. But you may want to thank him for what he's done. You may want to come and say, Lord, I'm tired of living for myself. I'm tired of deciding for myself. I'm tired of going where I want to go and doing what I want to do. And Lord, I want to be what you want me to be. See, he died for us. So the writer of Corinthians said we ought to live henceforth, that we should live for him. Our sister's going to play, preacher.
If you don't know Christ, right now be a good time. You come, let's take a Bible and show you how to be saved. Amen. Sing those things just a little bit.
Look what God has done for you. See what he has brought you through. He's done what no other can do. Look what God has done for you. When you are in trouble, he was your dearest friend.
How many can you identify with that?
And when you needed someone, he was there to the end. In your darkest hour, he's been faithful and true. And look what God has done for you. Look what God has done for you. See what he has brought you through. He's done what no other can do.